Well, good morning. How's everybody? Good. How many of you ate too much? Don't confess that. What'd y'all eat? Matthew 2, by the way, that's where we're going. Matthew 2. What'd y'all eat? What'd you have for Christmas? Soup? Turkey? Breakfast casserole. Okay? Huh? Chili. Lasagna! Gumbo. We did tamales. Yes, we did. We're going to do them again today. We got lots of tamales. They might want to come to the house. We have lots of tamales. They were delicious. There's a restaurant down the road from our house there that I didn't even know. It's a store. I didn't even know it existed. And it's by Sidelines there. You know where Sidelines is, up towards Lincoln. And there's a Mexican store there. And they got a little kitchen in the back of it. I didn't even know anything about it. And Kimberly said, I've placed the order. Go pick it up. Of course, that meant I had to pay for it, too. But it's good. It's good stuff. The chicken ones are rather spicy. They're good. They're just right. All right, I ran Pam off. I'm sorry. She'd run to get some tamales. She got so hungry. All right, Matthew chapter 2. We're going to read the first 12 verses. Please stand when you find this in honor of the Word of God. Matthew chapter 2. Here's what the Word of God says. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him. Now, we're going to skip down to verse 9 at this point. When they heard the king has told them where he is. When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Father, your word is true, your word is inerrant and infallible, it is unfailing in every sense, and we thank you. We thank you for this group that has come together this morning on this last Sunday of 2020. And I pray, Father, that you will prepare us for the days to come, for the challenges we will face, for the joys, for the heartaches. I pray, Father, that you will prepare us to be like these men, men who worship the Lord, worship the King with all of our heart. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, let me say to you that you did this, or any child were to attend a Bible study, especially at Christmas time, or maybe a worship service at Christmas, it's probable they're going to see something about the wise men. And more often than not, it's how many? Three. We don't know how many there were. We have no idea. We just know that the word is in the plural. And so there it is. We see them sometimes come marching down the aisle in the middle of a musical drama, or we see them standing on the stage, or whatever, but we sing it. We three kings of Orient are. Well, or four, or maybe just two. We don't know. at this point. Doesn't matter, does it? But there's a lot in this story that really matters for us, and it matters for us that the priests and the scribes of Jerusalem have ignored the word of God, but these men adored the word of God. It matters that God revealed himself to them. I think that what they saw, by the way, was not a convergence of stars. I believe that it was actually or convergence of planets. In this case, it was a Shekinah glory of God. That's what I'm persuaded that they saw. And it matters to me that they were willing to cross a great distance, all the way from probably, according to all theologians I've read, Babylon, to come to this area and to face the danger of this despot named Herod. And these gifts, these three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. If we stop and we meditate for a moment, they'll speak to us. They have a word for us. They'll teach us these great and precious promises that God says he has in the word for us. And they point us to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so I want to speak about the gifts, the three gifts of the Magi. And I want to bring them to your attention this morning. I did a very brief devotional thought of this 2 years ago on December 23rd as we prepared for the Lord's Supper. But I have developed it and I have brought it to a fuller extent. I dare not say the fullest extent because I can't exhaust the Word of God and the truth in it. But I believe that this will minister to your hearts this morning. And we'll begin with the precious gift. The precious gift. And then we'll move to the priestly gift. And finally, we'll look at the prophetic gift. But this precious gift that we see first mentioned, they presented to him gold in that moment. The most precious gift of that day was gold. It was a very rare commodity. Few people walked around with gold on their hands. And many of you, if you're to look down, I'm wearing titanium, quite frankly, because my gold ring no longer fits my big knuckles. But many of us have a gold band on our hands. It might be white gold, it might be yellow gold, but nonetheless, we have it. Few people in those days had their hands on gold. They would often take nuggets of gold and hide those nuggets of gold and hold on to them as one of their commodities in the event of trouble. That's why Jesus said, watch out. You know, don't lay your treasures up on earth where thieves break in and steal and moth and rust will decay it. But let me tell you something about gold that I thought about as I read this. It's only pure. It's pure only after being refined in the fire. And in the beginning of his ministry, our Lord was gold refined in the fire when he faced the temptation of Satan. You remember the story, the 40 days in the desert when he fasted and prayed for 40 days and Satan came to him and tempted him at that time. The Bible says to us in the book of Hebrews that our Lord learned obedience through suffering. How many of you have ever thought of that about our Lord? He learned obedience through suffering. He had to be refined in fire, as it were. And gold is that way. And it's placed into a fire and it's placed at such a high temperature that it burns the impurities away. And sometimes you face that and I face that And we wonder why we're in the fire that we are in. And we forget that the Lord has the purpose of purifying us to make us more Christ-like. When you present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, you are saying that you are willing to be refined in the fire, to become gold, to be offered to the Lord Jesus Christ. When Laodicea became a church rich unto itself, Revelation chapter 3, the Lord told them, you need to buy gold refined in the fire. If you want a life before the Lord that is presentable, He's going to bring you through troubles. He's going to bring you through difficulties. He's going to bring you through challenges. You may, like I perhaps have thought before, say, I don't know if I signed up for this, Lord, when you're in the midst of something like that. You may wonder where God is. But I remember once three young men thrown into a fire, and there they walked around, and there was one like unto the Son of God in the midst with them. Let me promise you that our Lord will be with you when you are being refined in the fire itself. Gold, ladies and gentlemen, is a proper gift for the King of Kings. I want to tell you something. If these Magi were schooled in the teachings of Daniel, something that I believe is probable, then they would have been influenced by Daniel 9:25. Now you need to turn to that to understand what I'm saying. So look at Daniel 9:25 and let me show you what the truth of the Word of God says there. In Daniel 9:25, the word says this to us. Know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince. And you look at that and you say, wait a minute, that says the Prince. Well, the Hebrew word also means king or sovereign. By the way, until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again and the wall even in troublesome times. Babylon, as I said, is the probable location of these individuals. Babylon. And there, I believe, they probably were studied in these writings of Daniel. And there they would have recognized this dominion of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now some wonder if these Magi were, well, first of all, they weren't magicians. Some wonder if they were astrologers in the sense like you have today. And I don't believe that's even so, but if it were so, it just demonstrates one more thing, that the Lord can take anyone wherever they are in life and He can draw them. Amen? So keep that in mind and remember that when you think and wonder who they are and what they did. We do know they studied the stars. We are aware of that. But these men recognize the dominion of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, why would I say that? Well, in verse 11, When they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother and fell down and did what? Worshipped him. And then they presented their gifts to him. And the word for present is a worship word in and of itself, in the context that is given to us right there. They recognize the dominion of the Lord Jesus Christ. I wonder if he's Lord in your life. I wonder if it goes beyond head knowledge for you. I wonder if there's a place where you have said yes to the Lord Jesus Christ. This is a most appropriate gift. It's very proper for him to have it. You know, it's more than that. Around the throne right now, the elders, the 24 elders, they all wear crowns of gold and they cast them at the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord himself appears before John in the beginning of Revelation and he has a gold band around his waist. And when he descends from heaven at Armageddon, he'll have many crowns on his head because he's Lord of all. He's Lord of all. The most precious gift they gave was gold. But then they gave a priestly gift, frankincense. Let me tell you about frankincense. Let me describe the properties of this gift to you. It's from a tree that's found in Arabia and Somalia. This is where it comes from. It's the sap of the lubain tree, one whose roots run deep down into a limestone kind of sand. And they cut this tree, much like they do maple trees here, and they put a bucket, a pail underneath it, and they catch the sap of that tree. But when the sap falls out, it falls out and crystallizes in the shape of a teardrop. Imagine that. Keep that in mind. I'm going to bring it back to you in a moment. Frankincense has a purpose, you see. It's prepared for the altar of incense, Exodus chapter 30 and verse 34. But it was also prepared for the table of showbread or the bread of presence found in Leviticus chapter 24 verses 5 through 9. Frankincense was to be the pure frankincense and it could not be used for anything else. It was most holy unto the Lord. There's a holiness that extends to you and me, ladies and gentlemen. And so this frankincense was prohibited for daily use. Why? Because of what it portrays, ladies and gentlemen, your prayers, the prayers of God's people. Now remember, I told you that the raw form is shaped like a teardrop. And I want you to hear that. Because don't think that your tears and your weeping as you have prayed have gone unnoticed. The Lord sees them. The Lord has seen that. And that frankincense rises up, Revelation chapter 5, just as the prayers of God's people rise up before him. It shows us the intercession of the Lord Jesus Christ, whoever lives, to make intercession for us. But all those loaves of bread, those caught my attention this time. The other has been in the forefront of my mind. But as I studied this week and I began to study those 12 loaves of bread and how they took an equal portion of each one of those 12 loaves of bread, equal size, every single one of them, one for every tribe, of Israel, equal, none different from the other, none greater than the other, none smaller than the other, all of them equal, they were anointed with this frankincense, covered over each one of them. Why, ladies and gentlemen, this is a portrait of our consecration before Almighty God. This is God's pure and perfect provision for us. This is a picture of the perfect Word of God that we must grow by. Not just the sincere milk, but the bread of life that He gives us. The priests who ministered in the tabernacle and later in the temple were commanded to partake of this Lord's table. They were commanded to go to it and eat that bread in that moment. By the way, according to Peter, you're a priest before God. Every one of you. We are a kingdom of priests. Let me say it another way. The church, us, we are a royal priesthood. Each one of us. The priest, I'm going to say this again because you didn't hear it. The priest were commanded to partake of this bread. They were required to eat that bread before they left the temple or the tabernacle. They had to. Fresh bread with a fresh anointing was placed weekly on that table. You, ladies and gentlemen, need a fresh encounter with the Lord every week, every day. There's one more gift, and we have to mention it. It's the prophetic gift. It's myrrh. And myrrh prophesies the death of Jesus on the cross. In Mark chapter 15, verse 23, when they crucified Jesus, they tried to offer him, wine with myrrh in it, and he refused it in that moment. He would not drink it because it was a narcotic. It has this narcotic sense nature to it, and the Lord did not want his senses dulled at all. He wanted to taste the pain of sin for you and you and you and you and me, for all the world. He wanted to taste it all. Myrrh is used to perfume bodies at burial. And when they took Jesus off the cross after he had died, the Bible says in John 19:38 that among the spices that they used to cover when they hastily wrapped him, to cover him, was myrrh in that moment. But I want you to know something. Myrrh preaches the purpose of the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. I read something interesting this week that Adrian Rogers wrote several years ago. He said this: nowhere in the Bible are Christians told to remember the birth of Jesus, but we are told to remember the death of Jesus. The cradle that you don't see now, that was up here, the cradle's purpose is the cross. And I think it's true that what I'm about to say, that the more carnal a believer is, the more that believer will make of the birth of Jesus, and the less that believer will make of the death of Jesus Christ. Tough. We want to celebrate his birth, don't we? But he's born to die. And to be raised from the dead. I want to wrap this up. I'm pretty much finished. But I want to tell you that these Magi, I like the name it's given here in the New King James Version. They were wise men. I want to tell you why they were wise. They were wise because they were prepared. They were prepared when the priests and the scribes were not. When they came to the city of Jerusalem and they looked all over that city, nobody had any clue. What do you mean, King of the Jews? What are you talking about? That old rat Herod knew what it was because he had stolen the throne to begin with. He bought that throne. He knew exactly what he was talking about. What do you mean? I want you to be impressed by their promptness. When they saw the star in the east, they began to diligently search. And I think you need to remember their passion. When they saw the child, they bowed low and they worshiped. I want to tell you something. It's an impossible hypothetical, what I'm about to say. But if the Lord Jesus were to walk through those doors right back there right now, some of us wouldn't recognize him. Some of us wouldn't be impressed. All they saw was a baby. Now, you don't bow down and worship a man. So they knew there was something more to this man than just born a king. They knew it. They understood they were in the presence of Almighty God. And they had a passion to worship the Lord. They were wise. What about us? What about you and me? Father, thank you for this word. It's a simple word. But if we listen, there's a lot of truth in it. And I pray you'll stir our hearts now. Some of us present need a fresh encounter with the Lord. We knew the Lord. We met the Lord. We surrendered to him and gave our hearts to him, and he saved us. But we've just been so cold and distant, and now we need a fresh encounter. Some of us are that way. And I want to pray, Heavenly Father, that you will stir up hearts so that'll be true today. Someone today, Father, may need Jesus. They may need to repent and believe the gospel for the first time in their life. You know, I don't. Place them before you, Lord. And I ask the Holy Spirit to work and have His way. If you need Christ this morning, friend, He's ready to hear you. He's ready to save you. You just need to turn to Him. Use this time, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.